Welcome to the Business Continuity Plan Training for Water Utilities. This program provides training to support the use of the Business Continuity Plan template and guidance document developed by the Water Research Foundation. The training material is provided in a series of 14 self-paced modules. Each module aligns with the corresponding section of the template and guidance document. Each module takes 5 to 15 minutes to review. Users may use any or all modules as they deem appropriate. Throughout the training, certain acronyms will be used that are frequently used in business continuity planning and in the water sector. Please consult the acronym list in the guidance document for definitions of acronyms that are unfamiliar to you. The Water Research Foundation has partnered with the American Water Works Association and the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency on this project. All parties involved with the development of this toolbox take great pleasure in introducing this package. Please proceed to Module 1, Introduction to BCPs. Since 2003, the water sector has made important commitments and progress in assessing risk and vulnerabilities as a result of the Bioterrorism Act of 2002. Another important step toward resilience has been the publication of the J100 RAMCAP standard by ANSI/AWWA in January 2011. In this module, you'll learn how the process for business continuity planning complements and advances other valuable plans, but generates a more comprehensive approach to continuity of the business enterprise. Recent incidents have raised national awareness that hazards are in flux. Incidents that our society had not imagined, such as the terrorist attacks on 9/11/2001, as well as incidents for which our society had not planned adequately, such as Hurricane Katrina, have brought us to a new paradigm as we prepare for future incidents. As a critical infrastructure, the water sector bears a significant burden to continue operations during conditions resulting from all types of hazards. Through BCPs that address all hazard conditions, including limited staff, power outages, service disruption affecting supply chain or information technology, and physical damage to facilities, water systems are better prepared to overcome these obstacles and achieve their organizational mission of providing safe and clean water to their users. Recognizing this responsibility, many water utilities have covered significant ground in conducting vulnerability assessments and other risk assessments to better understand their risks. They have decreased their risk by implementing risk management plans to minimize the frequency or severity of possible events and their subsequent impacts. For those risks that cannot be prevented, many water utilities have developed emergency response plans, or ERPs, and conducted associated training for their staff. Much of the impetus for this work was prompted by the regulations resulting from the Bioterrorism Act of 2002. While the other types of plans are essential and help increase the resilience of water utilities, there's a recognized need to plan for business interruptions in the wake of disrupting incidents from all hazards and to return to normal as soon as possible. Module 1 of the guidance document provides background on business continuity planning and the different motivations for developing a plan. It includes success stories shared by utilities in their own words on how business continuity planning has helped them during potential crises. It includes a brief summary of the business case, or how to better understand how the benefits of having such a plan outweigh the cost of development, implementation, and maintenance. Finally, it provides the initial introduction to the training tool, which includes the guidance document and template. A business continuity plan is your investment in a more positive future for the utility itself, for the community you serve, for your employees, and for your customers. By means of background, the purpose and objective of the Water Research Foundation Project 4319, Business Continuity Plans for Water Utilities, was to develop a comprehensive and flexible model and toolbox for the development of BCP by diverse utilities across the water sector. The materials generated, including this training tool, used in conjunction with the guidance document and templates, will enable all water utilities and wastewater utilities to develop their own business continuity plans based on their size, risks, and other unique characteristics. The graphic on the right shows a perennial cycle of risk assessment and mitigation, emergency preparedness, response, and recovery. The two blue boxes, risk mitigation and recovery, are the focus of the water sector BCP guidance document and template. In 2007 and 2008, the American Water Works Association held seminars that raised sector awareness of BCP and identified the need to standardize BCP guidance for the water sector. In addition, the Water Sector Coordinating Council Strategic Roadmap, which was originally released in October 2008, listed the top priority activities to significantly mitigate risk in the water sector, including to provide guidance on business continuity planning in the water sector. This project was conducted in support of that mission. As you can see, there are numerous benefits to conducting business continuity planning. They include those tangible benefits that can be measured, as well as those intangible benefits, such as maintaining a positive relationship with customers and keeping employee morale high. They include addressing gaps in the existing emergency management system, such as business functions and administrative facilities, providing guidance for a business interruption, such as a power outage, strengthening a utility's ability to continue serving its customers, improving resource management and reputation, keeping employees engaged and employed, reducing downtime and associated costs, and improving the ability to survive through catastrophic incidents. The business case for BCP is addressed in later slides and in the guidance document. The term business case is routinely used and is applied to a wide spectrum of needs. For this discussion, a business case will answer the question, what happens if we take this course of action? For making the business case to develop a BCP for a water utility, it must demonstrate value. Water utilities, like any business, strive to fully embrace their missions. That would include the provision of a reliable supply of high-quality water supported by efficient support functions, such as administration and finances. Business continuity planning is an investment in helping to ensure system reliability and efficiency, as it minimizes the consequences of incidents that could interrupt or compromise operations. That'll never happen here. We've all heard that before. That mentality is often the biggest hurdle to investing in business continuity planning. Before a utility can entertain the idea of BCP and see the return on investment, they must first recognize that there are disruption and interruption risks to the system, and they must avoid downplaying those risks. Once a group perceives that there is a need for a BCP, the utility can then demonstrate that the costs of developing and maintaining a business continuity plan pale in comparison to the cost of a major disruption to the utility, or to the cost of many minor disruptions over time. Based on proven best practices, there are 7 steps in a formal process for developing a business case, with the first 2 being define the opportunity and identify alternatives. This process is based on developing a business case, expert solutions to everyday challenges, from the Harvard Business Review Press in 2010. The opportunity is to avoid costs during a catastrophic incident by utilizing a business continuity plan. To define the opportunity, make the connection between business continuity planning and how the plan sustains or maximizes revenue, improves customer satisfaction, and enhances consumer confidence. Next, there are alternatives that should be identified and evaluated. One alternative is to manage the BCP program by hiring new staff or a contractor or by utilizing existing staff. Another alternative is to continue without a business continuity plan. While this is not an alternative promoted by these materials, this should be addressed as one of the alternatives in the business case analysis for comparison. Steps 3 and 4 go hand in hand. Step 3 is to gather the data, and step 4 is to analyze it. In step 3, it is important to gather tangible and intangible cost data in support of alternatives identified in step 2. The water sector must not only plan for administrative business functions, but also for the resiliency of critical and often aging infrastructure. It is advisable to discuss the data collected with the Oversight Committee to ensure that the data collected for the business case is sufficient to address their primary concerns. In examining the alternatives to developing a BCP, it is important to correlate the avoided costs of each alternative with their potential identified in Step 3. Steps for analyzing alternatives include the following. List the dollar and non-dollar costs of various BCP alternatives. List the potential dollar costs of worst-case scenarios that could be avoided if a BCP is in place. List the potential non-dollar costs, for example, consumer confidence, of worst-case scenarios that could be avoided if a BCP is in place. Estimate when anticipated cost savings are expected. List any other unquantifiable benefits and costs. And finally, organize the information in a table for comparison. In step 5, use the analysis developed in step 4 and a utility-specific list of selection criteria to choose the best alternative for the utility. In step 6, when planning the implementation of a BCP, it is important to conduct the following activities: determine funding sources, develop milestones, identify the associated resources needed to develop and implement a BCP, and document results of the business case. Step 7 is crucial. It is critical that return on investment, or ROI, be effectively communicated to decision makers and then subsequently realized and shared. Communication should include presenting both tangible benefits that are quantified in dollars as well as intangible benefits that are described. It is important to share your utility's message and present it in a way that is most suitable for the decision makers. Making the business case is addressed in detail in the guidance document, and there is a tool included in an appendix to facilitate steps 3 and 4, data gathering and analysis. Not every water utility will need to or want to go through this process of making a case for business continuity. Some will intuitively see the value and return on investment and decide to develop and maintain the plan without a detailed or documented business case. Some water utilities, particularly the largest and most forward-thinking systems, have developed BCPs, but many have not. As previously mentioned, there are 3 parts to the BCP toolbox for the water sector. These BCP training modules, the BCP template, and the BCP guidance document. Together with this training package, the template and guidance document provide a comprehensive and flexible model and toolbox for the development of BCP by diverse utilities across the water sector. In the template, there are empty tables and bullets provided for the user. It is ready for you to fill in. It also provides a checklist to ensure that you have completed each section of your business continuity plan. To help you fill in the template, there is an accompanying guidance document. The guidance document is to be used with the BCP template. The information presented should be used as guidance, but users should also think beyond the examples and suggestions given. Not all of the guidance document and the template will apply to all water utilities. BCP developers should use what works for them and customize their BCP as much as possible. Each section of the template corresponds to a section in this guidance document. This guidance document gives examples, explanations, and other information that helps developers of a BCP use the template. There are call-out boxes throughout the document to provide guidance on how to scale certain aspects of the BCP, depending on the size of the utility, or to provide real-world examples of how different aspects of the BCP process have been implemented by different water utilities. Additionally, certain supplemental materials that may help with a collection of information for the BCP development have been provided in the appendices of this document. Please proceed to Training Module 2 to start a business continuity plan. A business continuity plan and program does not replace any other emergency management plan or document. It should complement and enhance a water utility's existing emergency management system. In this module, you'll learn how the BCP fits with other existing response, mitigation, and recovery plans to protect public health by supplying clean drinking water and treating wastewater continuously. It is important to clarify and establish the scope of the BCP as it is under development. While a small utility may only have a few employees and one facility, the scope should still be established to clearly define details such as the duration of disruption. Are there processes or operations that are excluded from the planning? Are there buildings that are excluded? Do you want to initially have a plan for your headquarters location and then phase in other operations such as water treatment? Perhaps there is an acceptance of a risk that therefore wouldn't have to be mitigated. These are examples of the many reasons to carefully clarify scope and then use that data as a core assumption. In addition to clarifying scope, the planning process also needs to assume that there will be full implementation. That would include a commitment to train staff on a regular basis, to have any necessary equipment and supplies ready for use, to test the plan regularly through training, such as tabletop exercises, and to update and revise the plan on a regular basis. These activities are all integral parts of an effective management system. A BCP is not meant to replace any other emergency management document or to replicate any other document. It should complement and enhance a water utility's existing emergency management system. Generally, the BCP will be a plan that pulls together other existing plans, although a water utility may choose to integrate their BCP into an existing plan or vice versa. A BCP should be customized for the specific utility and needs so that it can be used most effectively. An ERP or similar emergency plan is like a doctor that stops the bleeding, while a BCP is a procedure that keeps the heart of a utility pumping. Regarding the distinction between a BCP and a Continuity of Operations Plan, or COOP, the two are becoming increasingly synonymous, with a BCP focusing on financial impacts, which sometimes are not included in a COOP. A sampling of plans that may complement the BCP include hazard mitigation plans, for example, vulnerability assessments or risk analyses, standard operating procedures, such as documentation policy or timekeeping procedures, preparedness plans, for example, facility response plans or hazard-specific plans, response plans, which may include emergency response plans or incident management plans, and finally, recovery plans, which would include the BCP or COOP or even pandemic plans. Many organizations have a family of plans that comprise their overall emergency preparedness program. It is imperative that these plans are consistent so that conflicting guidance is not presented at the time it is needed most. Conflicting guidance can also be a focal point for criticism in the event of an incident that was poorly managed, which is yet another reason to ensure consistency. Many organizations, including utilities, have incident management plans, sometimes called emergency response plans, as the foundational plans in their programs. This would be consistent with the National Incident Management System. Another foundational plan is a crisis communications plan to ensure effective communications both internally and externally during an incident. The BCP under development needs to be consistent with those plans. The process of instituting plan revisions needs to be carefully managed, again to ensure consistency. When updates and/or revisions are made that impact other plans, those plans need to be updated also. Furthermore, the distribution of those documents needs to be checked at that time. Every water utility should appoint a BCP coordinator to lead the development of the BCP and maintain the effectiveness of the plan. Also, it is recommended that the BCP coordinator hold regular meetings with the BCP committee to garner support and coordination throughout the water utility organization. The characteristics of an effective BCP coordinator include natural leadership, decisiveness, and an ability to communicate well throughout all levels of the organization. Each water utility should establish a BCP committee to provide direction for the BCP and its management updates and reviews. The BCP committee should include representatives of the key departments or units of the utility, such as water treatment, water distribution, finance, and IT. Also, the BCP committee should ensure that the BCP coordinates well with other plans, policies, and procedures, as well as risk assessments, including vulnerability assessments, and other documents and reports that support the mission of the water utility. Senior management at the water utility should endorse the business continuity program by issuing an executive policy statement. The policy should identify the mission of the water utility and define basic roles and responsibilities to keep the program effective. The policy should also provide specific management staff with the authority to develop plans and implement recommended improvements. In accordance with the National Incident Management System, or NIMS, an incident is defined as an occurrence, natural or man-made, that requires a response to protect life or property. Based on this model and definition, most utilities have an incident management plan as the foundation for their one comprehensive plan or their suite of emergency response plans. This consistent terminology is important as many plans overlap. For example, a fire incident could be a business interruption incident. Many utilities have defined their incidents as a function of size and complexity, thus reflecting the ability of an incident command system, or ICS, to expand and contract. Different levels of incidents and the corresponding response procedures are typically categorized. Business disruption impacts can be similarly categorized. This incident definition may already be in an existing water utility plan, such as the Emergency Response Plan, or ERP. It is important to have an incident management system in place prior to developing a BCP, as a BCP does not replace an ERP during plan development. This figure shows the typical process of plan activation during an incident. In the event of an incident that threatens continuity of the utility and its mission, the BCP coordinator activates the BCP. BCP triggering incidents may include the following consequences: loss of a critical facility, loss of a critical system or process, loss of critical equipment, loss of critical material or supplies, or loss of critical mass of personnel. Once the plan is activated, alert notification procedures are followed to inform everyone who needs to know. A discussion of alert notification procedures is provided later in this presentation. Once the plan has been activated, the BCP coordinator or another designated person determines when to deactivate the plan. This decision is made based on their assessment that the continuity is acceptably recovered. Reconstitution includes processes and procedures to return to normal operations once the BCP coordinator determines normal business operations can be resumed. Reconstitution includes reclamation of legal rights, properties, and powers, and readiness to resume statutory obligations and responsibilities. Recovery process considerations include procedures for notification of employees, customers, and authorities of the return to normal operations, protocols for restarting equipment and controllers at the primary facility, accounting for all employees and equipment, vehicles, and supplies that may have been moved to alternate facilities, and writing an after-action report. Now here are a few more words about returning to normal operations. Employees will perform as they've been trained, but in the case of utilities, this applies to customers as well. Establish procedures to transition data, vital records, and databases back to the primary facility or operation. Security of the data at reconstitution is also restored to its original level. Each mission essential function requires treatment in the reconstitution protocol so that employees, customers, and authorities are confident of complete restoration. If an authority has legally transferred statutory responsibilities, the alternate utility must be legally relieved. Devolution is described in Section 10 of the BCP Guidance Manual as this: if all of the best planning efforts are not sufficient, and administration and rights, powers, property, and responsibility must be transferred to an outside entity, the utility is disintegrating or devolving due to the crisis caused by an unmanageable incident. In most utilities, the procedures for devolution are provided by state statutory regulations. Consult your state emergency planning department, emergency management association, or legal advisors for interpretation and procedures under your specific state statutes protecting public health. The BCP should provide direction for orderly transfer as prescribed by statute should the need arise. The business impact analysis is the final step in the risk assessment process, following hazard identification and vulnerability assessment. In the water sector, just as vulnerability assessment informs the water system emergency response plan, a business impact analysis informs the business continuity plan. The business impact analysis determines the effect of a disruption on stakeholders, revenues, and processes, and it can impact the ability to meet regulatory or contract requirements. Furthermore, while the disruption will likely cause the utility to incur unexpected costs, it may also impede its ability to bill customers and collect payments, even when there is no disruption in water service. Conducting a business impact analysis takes time and money, but in the long term it saves time and money in the BCP process. A common mistake in a BCP is to include too many business functions. The result is a BCP that is cumbersome to develop and maintain. The purpose of a business impact analysis is to reduce the continuity requirements to the minimum possible while ensuring that the water system will survive the disruption and continue its operations. The business impact analysis helps identify the maximum time frame before interruption of a mission essential function causes significant harm to the water system's mission. This time frame is called the recovery time objective, or RTO, which is described further in Module 3. This concludes Module 2. In Module 3, we will examine Mission Essential Functions, or MEF. One of the critical steps in preparing a BCP is to identify and analyze the Mission Essential Functions, or MEFs, of the utility. This may seem very easy at first look, but it is likely you will find the process a bit more complex due to internal and external interdependencies. In this module, you will learn to identify mission essential functions with best practices to lead your BCP committee to consensus. The objectives of this module are to identify MEFs, examine interdependencies, establish recovery time objectives, create a prioritization table, and recognize challenges to determining MEFs. Perhaps the most critical step in the development of a BCP is identifying the utility's MEFs. The core of BCP development is taking a hard look at which functions are mission essential and which are not. Although some are very common MEF among most water utilities, others could vary. Some examples will be provided in a moment. MEF are functions or activities in the utility that are essential to fulfilling the mission of the utility. For instance, if the mission of the utility is to provide to its consumers potable water that it buys from a wholesale source and then pumps to its customers, the ability to pump the water would be a mission essential function. Regardless of size, all water utilities have some functions that are mission essential and likely some that are not. Separating them is the key to this step in BCP development. It is important for each water utility to identify its own MEF. As shown in the examples provided in this module, there is no absolute set of MEF that apply across all water utilities. The recommended way to capture and identify all MEF is for the staff members of each unit of the utility to identify and prioritize what they believe to be the MEF in their units. This is best accomplished through representatives on the BCP committee. Some MEF are much easier to identify than others. In a moment, we will provide a few examples of some MEF that could be overlooked. During this process, it is important for units of the utility to identify supporting functions they provide for other units' MEFs. This examination of internal dependencies often identifies critical resources that may have otherwise been overlooked. It is often necessary to utilize questionnaire forms and/or one or more workshops to guide units in identifying their MEF. Sample questionnaire forms have been provided as an appendix to the guidance document. Internal interdependencies are instances in which one unit of the utility provides a service or resource that is critical to the MEF of the other. There is a chance of these functions being overlooked because they may not be MEF in the eyes of the unit that provides them. Examples of critical interdependencies include fueling for critical emergency repair vehicles, GIS systems used for critical dispatching, chemical ordering processes, and approvals for emergency purchases. For a utility that treats and distributes water drawn from a surface water source, raw water pumping, filtration, and disinfection, and finished water pumping are likely among its top MEF. Some MEF are relatively universal among water utilities, while some may be unique. In order to support those clear MEF, pump maintenance, vehicle fueling, and maintenance of critical chemical inventories are probably also MEF. Other examples of potential MEF include electrical generator maintenance and fueling, sanitary sewer overflow response, water quality sampling, and security. The example MEF we have provided thus far have all been operational in nature. There are also a number of executive and administrative functions that may be mission essential, such as sustaining employee safety functions, providing payroll checks to employees, purchasing critical or emergency materials and supplies, contracting for emergency repairs, and operating the Emergency Operations Center, or EOC. As mentioned, there are some functions that are usually not mission essential that could be mission essential in some systems, depending on the specific situation. For instance, reclaimed water production will generally not be an MEF. However, in a system where reclaimed water is provided to a critical customer, such as a power plant for cooling water or a hospital for chiller water, reclaimed water production could be an MEF. Similarly, in a system that produces electrical power that it needs for its own operations or for critical customers, that function would be mission essential. An important step in the identification and prioritization of MEF is the establishment of the time for return to operations for each MEF. This is sometimes also referred to as maximum tolerable downtime. While all MEF may need to be recovered within the 30-day BCP timeframe, some are needed more urgently than others. For instance, if the utility has several days of raw water storage at their water treatment plant, the RTO for raw water pumping may be 3 days. If, however, they have only about 12 hours of finished water storage, the RTO for finished water pumping might be more on the order of 12 hours. In this example, while both forms of pumping are MEF, the RTO for the finished water is shorter. As a result, finished water pumping would likely receive a higher prioritization. Once the prospective MEF have been gathered from the units of the utility, the BCP committee needs to confirm that they are actually mission essential and then prioritize them. Sometimes critical linkages arise that drive the order of the MEF. For example, if the ability to operate key motor vehicles and equipment is part of one or more MEF, then the ability to fuel those vehicles and equipment may also need to be an MEF, prioritized higher than would otherwise have been the case. The resulting MEF prioritization list may not be a large document, at only one to a few pages. However, it is often immensely valuable in prioritizing the response to and recovery from an incident. It is often helpful to start the MEF prioritization process by putting MEFs into groups such as low, medium, and high. One way to prioritize the MEF is to put each of the MEF on a sticky note, place all of the MEF on a wall, organize them into priority groups, and then go through a brainstorming exercise to work them into a specific priority order. It is important to undertake a serious brainstorming of the ranking of the MEF, as an appropriate BCP ranking for use in the recovery from a disaster incident may differ from the normal day-to-day perspective. For instance, in a utility that is in a seismically active area, the greatest threat to the system may be an earthquake with many main breaks in the distribution system. In that case, the utility might consider damage assessment, system isolation, and main break repairs more immediate than water production and pumping. In a utility that has determined that it will pump untreated water in the distribution system for fire protection and sanitation, even if the potable water cannot be produced, finished water pumping may be ranked above filtration and disinfection. There's no one-size-fits-all for MEF ranking. It is of critical importance that each water utility identify and rank its MEF based on the nuances of the individual system. The identification and prioritization of a utility's MEF may be the single most valuable outcome of the BCP process. It is important to capture and document that prioritization in a table that includes appropriate key information regarding each MEF. At a minimum, it should include the MEF rank, department, MEF description, and impact to the mission if the MEF is lost. Other information which may be appropriate could include the RTO for each MEF, the primary responsible person or position in the organization, critical resources, interdependencies, and the primary location of the assets associated with the MEF. There are a number of challenges in the process of identifying and prioritizing MEF. Many units of the utility feel that all their functions are mission essential, regardless of what they are. While all functions of the utility are mission essential in the broad sense, not all are MEF in the context of BCP. Many units of the utility also have fundamental difficulty identifying and prioritizing their functions, and one or more workshops may be needed to help them through this step. In order to capture all internal interdependencies, an intense examination of workflows may be needed. Finally, the prioritization process requires intense brainstorming by the BCP committee, whose members must be informed and engaged in the BCP process, as well as in the operations of their home units of the utility. We will now move on to Module 4 to look at critical resources. After identifying and prioritizing your MEF, identifying and planning for the critical resources necessary to sustain your mission essential functions are of nearly equal importance. In this module, you will learn the nature of critical resources and how to recognize and overcome challenges to having these critical resources available when necessary. We will also discuss the benefits of mutual aid and resource typing with respect to BCP. Once the MEF and a utility have been identified and prioritized, the next critical step in BCP development is to identify and address resources that are critical to the continuation of the MEF. For instance, if one MEF is to pump potable water and the pumps require electricity for their operation, then electrical power is a critical resource to that MEF. Water utilities of all sizes have critical resources, and their number and complexity vary somewhat in correlation to the size of the utility. Critical resources based on the NFPA 1600 guidance include facilities, such as a water treatment plant, equipment, such as a backhoe to repair water main breaks, materials, such as the pipe and repair couplings to repair the water main breaks, and other resources, such as raw water, treatment chemicals, electricity, and personnel. This slide shows the four categories of critical resources other than personnel and provides examples for each. There are, of course, many others in each category, as you will discover when creating your BCP. The identification and designation of mission essential personnel can be a challenging issue. No employee wants to be designated as non-essential. However, in the context of emergency response and business continuity, some employees may be less mission critical than others. The reality is that, at least on a short-term basis, treatment plant operators, mechanics, and some other employees are, in fact, more mission critical than meter readers and many other types of employees. Many utilities seek to establish a terminology for mission critical personnel that is less threatening to others, like key personnel. Some utilities develop plans to reassign non-essential personnel to other roles in BCP activations, such as assisting with disaster recovery or handling increased customer calls. Many utilities stress that all personnel are essential, especially in an emergency, but the roles they assume may differ from their normal roles depending on the nature of the emergency. Personnel are a utility's most valuable and most often overlooked resource. It is critically important to ensure that employees are prepared for their roles in a BCP activation. This includes ensuring that they know their BCP roles, they're trained in those roles, and have necessary equipment, and that delegations of authority and succession plans are in place, as discussed in a later module. Also, employees are only as valuable to the utility in an incident as they are prepared at home. Utilities should help their employees with guidance and training to ensure that their families and homes are prepared. When addressing critical resources, it is important to consider upstream and downstream resource factors. Upstream factors involve resources that are critical to your utility that may be impacted before the resources reach your utility. For instance, if an incident impacts your primary chemical supplier, you should have plans in place for an alternate supplier. Many BCP planning processes include examining whether critical suppliers have BCPs in place. Downstream factors involve your customers for whom your supply of water is especially critical, such as hospitals and critical manufacturers. After critical resources are identified, the utility needs to determine how they will address potential interruptions in the availability of those resources. This slide lists a few examples of critical resources and some of the potential opportunities to address interruptions. Others could include redundant treatment or pumping facilities or capacity, additional finished water storage, system interconnections, key mobile or portable equipment stored at multiple locations, cross-training of employees, or utilization of retired employees. Mutual aid is an increasingly viable option for utilities to obtain help and resources following an incident, whether it is a major regional disaster or a localized incident that exceeds the capabilities of the utility. The Water and Wastewater Agency Response Networks, also known as WARNs, were started in 2005 after Hurricane Katrina and have revolutionized mutual aid in the water sector. With WARN networks now formed in all 50 states and in Canada, WARN has become synonymous with water sector mutual aid. The WARN networks provide standardized mutual aid agreements that address legal issues such as workers' compensation provisions, established lines of communications, and mutual aid operations protocols and other guidance. In many states, the WARN agencies have a seat in the State Emergency Operations Center, which is extremely valuable in coordinating mutual aid between utilities in a major incident. To assist utilities in their coordination and communications efforts, AWWA established a national website, nationalwarn.org, that provides resources and contact information for each state WARN, as well as situation reports for events in progress. One of the resources found at nationalwarn.org is AWWA's Water and Wastewater Mutual Aid and Assistance Resource Typing Manual, released in 2008. This manual provides the details on 24 different types of teams for use in mutual aid between water and wastewater systems. An example of a team is a water distribution system damage assessment and repair team. For each of the teams, there are up to 4 different capability levels, providing nearly 100 different teams overall. The manual includes a spreadsheet for potential mutual aid responders to develop their costs, if needed, in the early stages of providing mutual aid. It also includes a mutual aid responders accommodations checklist. The checklist captures detailed information on the things that a responding team needs to bring to be able to function in the areas in which aid is provided. The concept of this checklist, which was developed in North Carolina following Hurricane Floyd in 1999, is to ensure that responders bring what they need to sustain themselves during a deployment, while minimizing the number of times that the recipient utility or community needs to explain it. The management of vital records is an important component of business continuity planning that is often overlooked in preparing the utility for survival and operation during the response, recovery, and reconstitution phases of critical incident management. Top-performing organizations have the information they need readily accessible, no matter what threatens. In this module, you will learn to enhance your business continuity planning process by incorporating some of today's best practices for vital records management in use by the water industry, as well as by other critical infrastructure sectors such as information technology, finance, communications, government, agriculture, and public health. Records are vital if the utility will be negatively impacted by their loss. Protection must include consideration of very sensitive information, such as risk assessment and personal information from customers and employees. To the extent possible, agencies should pre-position vital records and data at one or more alternate facilities and update duplicate records or backup electronic files on a regular basis. Access to current vital records supporting the MEFs is critical to sustainable service. The utility may already have a document management or administrative system that serves daily operation, but it may be insufficient for assuring the ability to survive and operate continuously to provide essential service to the community throughout a disaster recovery period. Accountability is a key concept, and for this reason, a vital records program should be established and managed with the same level of interest and oversight as other programs critical to the protection of public health. A vital records program identifies and protects those records that specify how an agency will operate in an emergency or disaster, those records necessary to the continuity of the MEFs, and those records needed to protect the legal and financial rights of the government and citizens. The vital records management program should be defined and specifically assigned in developing the BCP. Program management will then clarify what authorities and protection levels are necessary to use and transfer vital records to support the utility MEFs. Program requirements also include training the necessary staff, as well as periodic review and testing of employee implementation skills and established procedures. Vital records, databases, and information systems that directly support the mission essential functions of the water wastewater utility are critical to continuous service during times of emergency and recovery from disaster. Vital records may exist in several formats, such as paper, photographic, electronic, or engineering and architectural drawings, such as for pipelines and treatment operations. The format doesn't matter, but security and accessibility do. Only the managers of the utility can really determine which records and databases essentially support its MEFs. Identification of these records occurs in the analysis of essential functions, as each of the functions identified requires certain documents, processes, and procedures to either continue or reconstitute operations. A utility should analyze the consequence of loss certain documents such as photos, architectural drawings, pipeline maps, personnel records, or technical data associated with an MEF, and the cost of replacement in terms of time and legal implications, as well as money. Once identified, these should be addressed in the business continuity plan to determine the staff, storage, transfer, duplication, and protection necessary to ensure continued operation and legal protection. The BCP usually includes only those records that impact continuous operation of the MEFs, although the program and procedures may then be adapted as general practice throughout the utility during routine operation, if the budget permits. Guidance for identifying and managing vital records comes from formal materials, such as public law, regulations, and official statements from federal, state, and local authorities, and from informal sources, such as information sharing and analysis centers, or ISACs, professional associations, conferences, newsletters, and internal management reviews. Don't overlook the valuable guidance available to you by networking with other utilities that have already established vital records programs. Whether you have a separate IT department or section, have an information systems manager as an additional duty, or even simply a network administrator, the disaster recovery plan for IT is very important to your BCP. In some small utilities that are subordinate to a municipality, county, or private enterprise, IT systems management may lie entirely outside your staff. In this case, it is particularly important to examine the DRP to ensure it meets your critical need for RTO, a component of the maximum tolerable downtime for your MEFs. You may also need to seek guidance outside the typical water critical infrastructure. For example, the General Services Administration issues guidance for document storage and management, including information security. The U.S. Department of Homeland Security website also offers an information technology sector-specific plan supporting the National Infrastructure Protection Plan that guides continuity in data automation, electronic storage, recovery operations, and disaster mitigation plans. In your BCP, define the documentation, protection required, and access desired to ensure that your MEFs will continue as expected. Then clarify what authorities and protection levels are necessary to use and transfer vital records to support the utility MEFs. Program requirements also include training the continuity staff. Employees responsible for use, distribution, application, storage, and relocation of data necessary to perform MEFs in both the operational and legal or financial domains must receive appropriate training. Periodic review and testing of employee implementation skills and established procedures will ingrain such procedures into administrative routines as well. The utility should have policies, procedures, and vital records inventory that address tracking and replacement requirements. Federal Preparedness Circular 65, June 2004, is a good reference for this. It recommends that staff assigned to the alternate operations facility be able to access vital records within 12 hours of implementation of the BCP. They will need at least a local area network capability, vital electronic and hard copy records, critical information systems, and internal and external email and archives. Once media for storage has been selected, be sure to equip the alternate operations facility with the necessary readers and operating systems. Once identified, these should be addressed in the business continuity plan to designate the staff, storage, transfer, duplication, and protection necessary to ensure continued operation and legal protection. Include legal, financial, and compliance reporting in identifying vital records for utilities. Data systems, sources of systems, such as vendors, equipment and storage, along with appropriate alternatives, should also be considered. Trained and available personnel to collect, manage, and distribute vital records throughout the utility is a serious consideration because of the sensitivity of data and systems. Relocation procedures and alternate facility operations should always include provisions for protection and accessibility of vital records. Go kits or fly away kits are addressed in the guidance manual. However, it is worth noting here that the key personnel or team assigned vital records management responsibilities must also build such kits comprised of packaged records, equipment, PCs and power sources, primary sources of information, and backup and communication equipment with a level of security appropriate for its sensitivity. There are two levels of designated recovery teams: the one that repairs and recovers the software or replaces software, and the one charged with recovering the vital records. In general, there are two types of records that need protection and are fully treated in the business continuity plan: emergency operations records and legal or financial records. Emergency operations records include distribution and collection system maps and supporting information, facility plans and drawings, technical data for equipment and operating systems, customer information, vendor and supplier information, employee documentation of certifications, emergency contact information for employees and suppliers, standard operating procedures, and equipment maintenance information. Legal and financial records typically include contracts, mutual aid agreements, deeds for properties, easements, compliance reporting data, safety performance histories, insurance and bond data, and court consent decrees. You should decide how to categorize the documents that are critical to your selected MEFs. The category selected will in turn inform decisions as to system management, protection level, retrieval requirements, and storage sites. Each consideration will suggest additional need assessment for employees, training, authorities, and exercises for validation and continuous improvement. In customizing a business continuity plan, consider scalability. Your list can be expanded or reduced as you need. The following slides display items that should be considered and demonstrate the types of the categories of vital records. Listed here are examples of vital record categories for emergency operations and the types of records routinely maintained in each. As you develop your BCP, remember to focus on those which support sustained MEF. Resources used in recovery and reconstitution could include management information systems, automated maintenance systems, mutual aid and assistance contact and data, pre-positioning data for equipment, vehicles, and inventory, and plans such as BCPs, ERPs, and associated rip and runs. Manuals may include emergency operations instructions or procedures, continuity instructions, standard operating procedures, or technical manuals and product descriptions, including nomenclature, serial numbers, and model numbers. Diagrams, schematics, and drawings that may be needed are pipeline maps, valve locations and descriptions, water quality data points, including sensors and sampling stations, blueprints, maps of the service area, and security system information, including alarms, entry control points, keys, and codes. Contact data for staff should be available and should include their authorities, emergency contact telephone numbers, street address for home and office, and out-of-area contact information. It should also include their expertise and MEF assignment. The vendor supply chain category demands several levels of alternates, as vendors may be committed to a number of customers during a crisis. A priority delivery schedule may be in effect, or a widespread disaster could delay or prevent delivery from local providers. Types of information to include are primary and secondary contact data for primary and secondary vendors, recovery experts, including records recovery and debris removal, contracts and reliability data, geographic location and street address, primary and secondary delivery and transport information, and purchase and payment information. Here are examples of categories for legal and financial vital records. Again, as you develop your BCP, remember to focus on those which support sustained MEF. As you can see, there are many categories of legal and financial records to consider. Under each of these categories are many examples, and we encourage you to consult Section 5 of the BCP guidance document for a detailed list of these examples. Hardening or providing security for all facilities that house utility vital records would likely prove too expensive a proposition. Remember, best practices are risk-based and economical. Customize the vital records plan and the disaster recovery plan for your circumstances and threat levels. Possible actions to ensure physical security of records are to duplicate and geographically separate servers, scan paper records, store records in fireproof containers, store duplicate records at an off-site location, select off-site storage facilities and alternate operating locations that provide all hazard protection, convert vital records to microfilm or digital copies, duplicate records at the time of creation, and update records in Go kits frequently. Availability means that your employees can access information they require whenever they require it. Keys, codes, and password protection apply here, but sometimes access issues temporarily override security considerations. To make records available, you should ensure web access and email at the alternate location or even at employee homes. Plan accessibility to critical national databases and ISACs. Prepare to transfer main office phone and customer service numbers to off-site locations, and pre-position plans, delegations of authorities, and building permits at the alternate operating location or at an off-site storage facility. Large utilities may have facilities that are separated enough geographically to provide storage or have funds available for cloud storage solutions. Small utilities may participate in their warrants with storage and access solutions. It is important to mitigate the risk of loss or destruction of your vital records, which should be approached through multiple efforts, including policies and procedures, hardware-software configurations, data backup and restoration procedures, troubleshooting guides, business recovery plans, and pre-positioning of resources. In general, best practices in the vital records program are associated with the standards and guidance documents and generally apply to either risk reduction or mitigation. These are some specific actions that can help protect your vital records. Assign responsibilities for vital records protection and management. Ensure identified vital records evaluated are necessary for emergency operations or to protect the rights and interests of citizens or the utility. Assure availability and appropriate access at the alternate operating location and/or EOC. Safeguard legal and financial records essential to the preservation of the legal rights and interests of the utility, customers, and public health. Ensure vital records are easily retrieved and properly maintained. Outline procedures for and prioritize the recovery of vital records during an emergency. Ensure damage to vital records during an emergency is minimized and plan for mitigation in the event of damage. Provide procedures for the recovery of damaged records, including paper and electronic records. Replicate agency servers at an off-site facility. Scan all paper records and store on a secure computer. Duplicate all records at the time of their creation with backup tapes. Store duplicate records in fireproof files, vaults, and safes at the primary facility and, if possible, at an off-site facility. Finally, protect off-site facilities from all hazards. The chart on this slide is one approach to controlling the vital records plan, especially when alternate operating facilities, off-site storage, or continuity and recovery teams are built into the BCP, or when the DRP is included. A current inventory of vital records should be readily accessible at the alternate operating location. This chart is located in Appendix E of the BCP template and is extracted from FPC 65. Many other examples are available online. A Vital Records Go kit may be useful for employees who know they will have to relocate to an alternate operating location or who will serve as members of continuity teams. These Go kits include contact lists for key and disaster personnel with current phone numbers, vital records and inventory with exact locations, keys and codes, alternate facility locations, access and passwords for electronic files, keys for file cabinets, combinations for safes, lists of appropriate emergency and document recovery vendors, and the BCP pertaining to vital records with appropriate rip and run sheets. If you work in a large utility, the disaster recovery plan may be managed by IT staff. However, in small utilities, the IT staff is frequently a secondary job description, or perhaps IT support is even administered by employees in a different organization. Each case places specific but very different continuity demands on the utility. Remember, your BCP is meant to ensure the continuity of your utility MEFs. Once you've planned a strategy for ensuring accessibility, protection, currency, and maintenance of vital records, test those procedures to determine whether your strategy is valid given the threats you anticipate. An important objective for any IT or vital records exercise under the BCP is to determine how well vendors and suppliers can respond to your request for emergency assistance. Will the entire network or telecommunications system be down? What priority has been established for responding to your claim for service? Recovery time objective and recovery point objective are two metrics used by IT system administrators to determine how fast your automated systems are to return to full operation and to what backup point restoration is to be made. For example, if your utility can meet its MEF obligations without information systems for 12 hours, then the RTO might be set at 9 hours, with the RPO set at 0 to 2 hours prior to the crash. Although you do not need to be an expert in IT systems, you should be knowledgeable enough to provide direction based on your risk assessment. The National Archives and Record Administration, NARA, issues guidance concerning vital records and associated protection and accessibility measures. This guidance is not specific to the needs of water wastewater utility operations, but you may find it useful. Guidance concerning automated information systems is also available from the IT-ISAC, an Information Technology Sector-Specific Protection Plan. Additional guidance for identifying vital records is available from your local county emergency management office and the U.S. EPA in the Water Security Division. Please proceed to Training Module 6, Establishing Alternate Facilities. Whenever the BCP is implemented, you'll find it most helpful to have considered in advance the possibility of operating or controlling some mission essential functions from an alternate facility or center. This is a critical component of BCP because prior planning creates a logistical advantage during an incident requiring extensive recovery and reconstitution time. In this module, you will learn best practices for identifying, selecting, stocking, and staffing alternate facilities. Some utility functions are very difficult, if not impossible, to relocate, such as treatment and pumping facilities. Continuity of those facilities must be achieved through redundancy, robustness, and on-site recovery. For those functions that can be relocated, such as leadership, administrative, and maintenance functions, provisions should be made for those alternate facilities. Alternate arrangements may include relocation to other facilities owned by the utilities, other facilities owned by the parent municipality or other parent organization, advance arrangements for privately owned facilities, or last-minute arrangements for privately owned facilities. Teleworking may be an option for some employees, although it is usually not a major option for utilities. While alternate facilities are relevant for water utilities of all sizes, they are a more significant need for larger utilities. Owned facilities are the most common form of relocation sites. This entails the use of other facilities of the utility or the utility's parent agency. In some cases, this may entail locating staff in available space in facilities such as treatment plants. In other cases, it may entail taking over facilities that do not have other MEF, such as community centers or schools. One major water system has a plan in which each group of its administrative division moves to one of its other facilities, treatment plants and operation centers. At those alternative facilities, conference rooms and other general and available spaces become workspaces for relocated administrative staff. Each group knows the facility to which they will relocate if needed, and each individual knows the specific office or room in which they will be located. Pre-contracted facilities are the least used option for relocation space, and as the name indicates, require that the utility contract for their availability in advance. While this has been a common practice for IT disaster recovery warm or hot sites, and some major information and communications operational facilities, it has otherwise not been very common among water utilities. It is, however, growing in popularity for the relocation of other administrative functions, particularly customer service call centers. There are facilities that provide this service in all urban areas. For some functions, such as IT recovery sites, it is not uncommon for the recovery site to be in a different city. In that way, when a disaster incident hits the primary location, the recovery site is not likely impacted by the incident. Lastly, a common and often last resort option for obtaining relocation space is through emergency acquisition of vacant space or portable facilities. Although this is the last resort in the logical sequence of options, it is the option currently used by municipalities. Existing facilities that may be suitable include vacant offices, flex spaces, warehouses, big box stores, and others. In order for this option to be viable, it is recommended that some of the utility maintains a sense of spaces available in the area and the major entities that manage or represent those facilities. In one major municipality, the city real estate office maintains close communications with local commercial realtors and major commercial property management companies. When the need for a shelter for Hurricane Katrina evacuees arose over a weekend, they were quickly able to identify a suitable available facility. Potential relocation facilities must have the necessary infrastructure in place to support the relocated functions, including electrical supply and wiring network with adequate reliability or backup, IT wiring network, communications network, and employee support facilities such as restrooms. Specific plans should be made for the resources that will be needed in a relocation, such as furnishings, computers and other IT hardware, telephones, office supplies, and other resources needed in the execution of the work. Specific prior plans and procedures should be established for the potential relocation. For instance, if the plan is for leadership and administrative personnel to relocate to facilities owned by the utility, plans should be made for the specific location to which each employee should relocate. Specific relocation plans should be communicated to employees so they know in advance where to go in a relocation. If the plan is to make last-minute arrangements for privately owned facilities, a unit of the utility should remain cognizant of potentially available facilities in the community, and general plans should be made to identify the organizational units that most depend on co-location with each other. When selecting alternate facilities, keep in mind that some of your employees may depend on public transportation. Your utility will operate more smoothly if getting to work is not a hardship for these employees. Finally, be sure to have protocols in place for returning to normal operations. Whether you're returning to your old location or establishing a new one, a well-planned move is essential for continuity of business. Basic utilities such as water, power, internet, and telephone should be fully restored before the move occurs. Your IT staff will be critical to a smooth transition as they restore information systems and ensure that all users have the electronic systems and data necessary to perform their daily tasks. Depending on the complexity of the move, it may be less stressful on all personnel to relocate them one unit at a time. This will allow IT and building operations personnel to identify and correct common problems before they impact the entire organization. We will now move on to Module 7, Delegations of Authority. Implementation of the BCP in your utility may occur when the routine leadership is unavailable for any number of reasons. Successful implementation will then fall to subordinates or individuals who have been selected in advance. If these individuals have been informed of their roles, properly trained, and have the appropriate delegations of authority in place so that they can support their MEF roles, execution of the BCP will be much easier. In this module, you will learn some best practices for ensuring that the most knowledgeable staff are available and properly prepared in the event implementation of your BCP is required. The discussion of delegations of authority and succession planning, which is the topic of the next module, are closely related. While succession plans document adequate backups and redundancy of individuals responsible for key operational processes, as well as decision makers, delegations of authority give new and necessary authority to employees who have been placed in different positions during the activation of your business continuity plan. These new authorities are important elements of your business continuity plan because they help protect against potential delays caused while waiting for specific personnel to show up, or delays caused by having to gain the correct authority needed at the time of the disaster. The delegations of authority in your business continuity plan do not include the transfer of the full responsibility of a position that normally accomplishes them, but allow the delegated employees to perform specific tasks necessary for recovery efforts. Delegations of authority are also used to give individuals in backup positions the authority to be effective. Individuals will likely be filling new roles during an emergency to take over for staff who are unavailable. The delegations of authority documented in this section of your plan will enable operational tasks to resume effectively, assuming the proper training occurs before the disaster happens. The authorities created in this section of your plan enable your recovery personnel to be successful. They were able to execute the tasks they were assigned without delays that could occur while waiting for permission. Some delegations of authority may be due to legal reasons, for example, limited signers for approving a document. But most are because of the separations of duty that exist in daily operations. When developing your delegations of authority for critical support functions, it is best to aim for at least 3 personnel deep. We have learned from recent disasters that having adequate backups in place will help protect your mission essential functions from recovery delays. If possible, consider delegating personnel from different physical locations the same authority for a specific task. This practice will increase the viability of the plan, which in turn increases the resiliency of your utility. Once you have completed your delegations of authority section of the template, check that your mission essential functions have adequate coverage. All essential functions should have multiple personnel trained, as well as adequate authorities in place to execute them. Here are some additional guidelines to keep in mind when completing the delegations of authority section of the template. It is a good practice to follow the guidelines from the National Incident Management System and the related Incident Command System. These guidelines standardize the terminology between water utility personnel and first responders. Additionally, whenever possible, name positions by title rather than using actual names of individuals. This minimizes the need for planned maintenance as people move around within the utility. But be sure all titles cross-reference to current names in the contact list within your plan. Authorities should be delegated to various personnel within or in some cases outside the utility. Delegating too much authority to any one individual will place too much of a burden on that person. Plus, it is better to spread the authority to execute critical tasks among numerous individuals. Remember to inform and train personnel how to perform the new tasks they have been given. Be sure training is a part of your business continuity planning process. Please proceed to Training Module 8, Succession Planning. Implementation of the BCP in your utility may occur when routine leadership is unavailable. Successful implementation will then fall to subordinates or individuals who have been selected in advance. If these individuals have been informed of their role, properly trained, and have the appropriate delegations of authority in order so that they can support their MEF roles, execution of the BCP will be much easier. In this module, you'll learn some of the best practices for ensuring that the most knowledgeable staff are available and properly prepared in the event implementation of your BCP is required. Succession plans may be needed in a BCP activation when the personnel normally in charge or who normally execute mission essential functions are unavailable. It is important to have adequate backups and redundancy in critical areas of your utility business. The succession plans documented here will only be activated in the case of a disaster or business interruption. It is important to note that the succession plan within the BCP does not replace official management succession plans, but rather complements them by identifying backups for additional critical staff so delays in recovery can be avoided. This is especially necessary with roles that have specific legal requirements or have a key operational role or authority. Finally, on this slide, consider how state and local regulations may dictate the timeliness of your operations and plan accordingly. Some missed deadlines have severe consequences. Those are the areas where you want to have several trained backup personnel in place. Succession planning documents who will take over for the incumbent of another position should they not be available to fulfill MEFs. An important distinction of succession planning is that the person taking over the role takes over the entire responsibility of the missing position, rather than just the ability and permission to accomplish one or more particular tasks. It is also important to understand that not all positions need a line of succession, though as the guidance document suggests, it is always more than the managerial roles that need to be evaluated. Listed here are some examples of likely water utility candidates who would usually have a line of succession in place. Important roles and positions need trained backups in place and available to enable effective recoveries. Developing the succession lines in your BCP is the easy part. It gets more challenging to ensure that the backup personnel you have indicated in the plan have the opportunity to be adequately trained for their possible disaster roles. Training backup personnel for all critical positions before the disaster occurs is key to ensuring a successful and timely recovery. When setting up lines of succession, the following guidelines should be kept in mind. As with the delegations of authority, follow the guidelines from the National Incident Management System and the related Incident Command System. These guidelines standardize the terminology between water utility personnel and first responders. Also, it is a best practice to name positions by title rather than using actual names of individuals. This minimizes the need for planned maintenance as people move around within the utility. But be sure all titles cross-reference to current names in the contact list within the BCP. Authorities should be delegated to various personnel within, or in some cases outside, the utility. Delegating too much authority to any one individual will place too much of a burden on that person. It is better to spread the authority to execute critical tasks among numerous individuals. The easy part is filling in the names of the personnel who will need to have new authority to execute their assignments within the plan. The more challenging task is to inform and train those employees on how to perform that new task in a disaster. Be sure training is a part of your planning process. We have learned through experience with disasters that these succession lines need to be at least 3 staff deep to be effective. It really is all about being able to contact someone in a timely manner. Whenever possible, use staff from different locations to populate your succession line. This builds resiliency into your plan. Succession planning applies to all organizations and all water utilities, large and small. Developing and documenting backup personnel is an integral part of developing a BCP and may be the difference between a timely recovery and a delayed response effort. Within smaller systems, it may require greater creativity to identify persons to whom succession can be passed. Sometimes it may be necessary to look outside of the utility or to a neighboring utility to find staff to provide sufficient backup. Your state's WARN can be an excellent resource for locating outside resources. We will now move on to Module 9, Alert Notification Procedures. Communication becomes more difficult and more important during an incident and will continue to be critical to sustained operation of the MEFs during recovery and reconstitution. The discussion in this module supplements any crisis communication plan you may have created within your utility and provides best practice considerations for institutionalizing clear and timely communications in your BCP. As the guidance document suggests, the alert notification section of the BCP template establishes the communication procedures for business continuity plan activation by referencing the crisis communication plan. The crisis communication plan supporting the BCP should include all internal and external communication requirements. The alert notification section addresses how to contact staff to alert them that something has happened. These procedures are not meant to replace the crisis communication plan, but to complement it. Create procedures to enable you to contact all staff and refer to the crisis communication plan when appropriate. At a minimum, the communication message should state that the BCP has been activated, describe the emergency situation, and explain the needs, including any special assignments. Everyone should know their role in the BCP before the time is activated, which can keep messaging simple. One method of alert notification is the internal call tree. This vehicle allows personnel within the organization to become aware and gain access to information during and after an incident. Messaging could include directions for reporting to work, special duties required, and availability of resources. If an internal call tree already exists, there is no need to create another one. Simply include information within your BCP to point to the existing call tree for the utility. Other methods of internal emergency communications include automated outbound telephone notification systems, designated inbound employee information numbers, the use of the media, and others. This section should also include how to communicate with employees when electricity is not available. Confirm that you have adequate battery or generator backup for your communication equipment. External communication procedures should already be addressed in your crisis communication plan. Most external messaging, especially to the media, should be handled through a public information officer, or PIO, or their equivalent. Again, some smaller utilities may not have enough staff to communicate effectively. If so, you may want to inquire with neighboring utilities to assist you when needed. You can also communicate in person to an employee's home if necessary. It is important to remember that you may have key external contacts that should be made aware of the situation. These key contacts should be identified within this section and documented accordingly. Of course, first responders will be notified of any significant incident at your facility. Keep in mind that if you experience a regional disaster, first responders may not be available to assist you. Prepare yourself and your utility to be self-sufficient if the need arises. Think about other external notifications that should be made if your utility experienced a major disruption. Other governmental agencies, other utilities, the most critical customers, and suppliers may all be candidates for your external notification procedures. Any entity that the utility is dependent upon or has interdependencies with should be considered in this section. Redundancy in communication methods is key to successfully communicating during and after a crisis. Multiple methods of communication may be necessary before you can communicate with all employees. Educate all participants within your alert notification plan that there may be multiple diverse ways that you may try to communicate with them. This is important so that they know what to expect. Some other methods include phone, email, text messaging, emergency notification systems, or a social media tool such as Facebook. Specific television and radio stations may also be selected. And of course, there are always face-to-face communications. We will now move on to Module 10, Devolution. If you've been completing your template as you've gone through these training modules, your basic business continuity plan is complete. However, sometimes despite our best efforts, the plan may not be adequate to control the crisis at hand. At this point, it may be necessary to consider devolution. In this module, we'll briefly explain what devolution means, as well as when and how your utility would devolve. Devolution is the act of transferring responsibilities and authorities for all or part of a utility's operations to an outside entity. This is a legal transfer that must be legally reversed once a utility is ready to resume control of its operations. It is hard to imagine a situation in which devolution would occur, especially for larger utilities. However, consider a small utility which loses a significant part of its personnel to illness or a tragic accident. The utility infrastructure may be intact, but there are no qualified employees to operate the utility. At that point, the utility may need to devolve authorities and responsibilities to another entity in order to continue supplying clean drinking water that is vital to public health. In many states, devolution procedures are dictated by state statute. At any rate, there will be a legal transfer of authority to the entity that is assuming responsibility for operations of your utility. The state may decide which entity will assume control of your operations and to what extent. If you are not bound by state statute, you may be able to work with a neighboring utility or a contract operator to provide the needed services. It is very likely that you will already be in contact with your state primacy agency at the time of the crisis, but it is better to contact them during the planning processes so that you can incorporate procedures into your BCP. While the utility is in devolution, it is important to let certain groups of people know who to contact for their specific needs. Your employees should be informed of the circumstances through your alert notification system that you previously established, and they should be informed where and when to report for work. Your customers will need to know who to contact to report water quality issues or other service problems. Finally, the state primacy agency will need to know who to contact to ensure that safe drinking water is being delivered to the community. Please proceed to Training Module 11, Reconstitution. In this brief module, we will explain the meaning and purpose of reconstitution. We will describe the conditions under which the utility is ready for reconstitution to occur, and we will also explain the procedures involved in reconstitution. Reconstitution is the process of returning to normal operations. At the end of Module 6, we recognize the need to have a solid plan to return to operations. Reconstitution includes the physical relocation to your restored or new facilities, but it also includes restoration of rights and authorities that may have devolved to other agencies. Reconstitution should occur when the Business Continuity Planning Coordinator and utility authorities determine that normal operations can be resumed. This means that they have restored the facilities to working order, have re-established necessary supply chains, and have an available labor force capable of operating the facilities. Reconstitution means that the utility is ready to resume all its previous obligations, including statutory compliance. One of the first steps to resuming operations is to reclaim your rights and authorities if these were transferred through devolution. After that, stakeholders should be notified of the intent to return to normal operations, and they should be informed of the duration of the transition, as well as what they should expect during the transition. Protocols for restarting facilities should be reviewed if necessary, and equipment, vehicles, and supplies from alternate facilities should be inventoried and retrieved. Finally, the protocols for migrating data back to the primary facility should be reviewed and carefully executed. Please proceed to Module 12, Tests, Training, and Exercises. It is very likely that staff will assume unfamiliar positions upon implementation of the BCP. Best practices include making designated BCP staff as comfortable in the BCP position as possible before they need to use checklists and support documentation or unfamiliar equipment. In this module, you will learn best practices for testing and training your staff to use the BCP. You will also learn exercises designed to familiarize them with implementation of the plan should the need arise. The primary goal of a testing, training, and exercise, or TTE program for the Business Continuity Plan is to confirm that employees know what to do in an emergency to maintain and protect the public health of the community through utility services. One purpose is to inform knowledgeable staff that the information and resources they require is in place to implement the BCP. Training and testing and exercises elevate the level of confidence employees, managers, and customers have in the utility's ability to continue providing critical services. Results of tests and exercise evaluations expose gaps in performance or prove the effectiveness of the BCP. Once you identify the problems, you should enter these into the corrective action program with specific dates and employees for results. This is accountability, and it completes the planning cycle so that continuous improvement is achieved. Include an annual schedule for TTE in your BCP. The BCP Coordinator Committee and Utility Executive should review and approve the annual schedule for maximum benefit. The annual schedule is used to budget for employee time, training venues, and facilitation. Water industry employees are very familiar and comfortable with all sorts of chemical process and equipment tests and checks. You should provide every possible opportunity to test and use BCP procedures, equipment, and relationships before you need them. This type of test can be applied to continuity planning as well, laying the foundation for a resilient organization and a sustainable commitment to maintaining the public health. Equipment should be tested on a regular basis using the technical manual, and new equipment should be tested when it is installed. The spare parts inventory should be inspected periodically to determine status. All communications equipment and systems and IT systems intended for use at alternate facilities should be tested periodically. IT system tests for the BCP should focus on availability. New and alternate facilities should be tested to determine if resources are available and operational, and if employees can access them properly. Test the components of your BCP at least annually, but preferably two or three times a year. A test of the notification system is not very expensive, but it is critical that rosters, telephone numbers, keys, and passwords are current and accurate. You should test procedures for transporting vital documents, portable PCs, protective clothing, and lab equipment, as well as procedures for using them at the alternate location. Test employees' skills regularly, for example, during drills, competitions, and before promotion, regarding manual alternatives including intrusion detection, contamination detection, notifications such as return to duty or boil water announcements, locating and turning valves, and reading meters. Test and exercise procedures to relocate to and physically use the alternate facilities in your plan to determine accessibility, power, communication systems, water, restrooms, rest areas, air conditioning or filtration, cleaning supplies, first aid kits, and vehicle support if needed. The most formidable alternate facility in the world may be useless to the BCP if employees cannot find it, don't have keys when they get there, cannot refuel vehicles nearby, or if the power is off. In general, define your training programs to fit the specific BCP. Make training and exercises interesting and rewarding. After all, you will be working with adults and skilled technicians. Make sure there is appropriate level and frequency of training for employees with specialized, key, or complex roles in the BCP or in its planning process. Here's a few tips. Conduct tests, training, and exercises periodically to ensure that those who have a role in the plan are competent to fulfill that role during an incident. Include a BCP overview as part of new employee orientation training or when employees receive BCP assignments that may not routinely be assigned. Employees do not have to receive training on the entire plan in one session. Some training is best done in the workplace while on the job. For example, allow successors to occupy their BCP assignment as a routine. Employees will need additional training when the plan is changed. Include all key personnel on your training roster and update the roster when key staff leave or join the utility. Finally, don't forget to document the BCP training as well as any certifications required to operate the water system in compliance with regulatory standards. This can be very important to filling BCP assignments with staff available during an incident. An exercise is an instrument to train for, assess, practice, and improve performance in prevention, protection, response, and recovery capabilities in a risk-free environment. Exercises can be used for testing and validating policies, plans, procedures, training equipment, and interagency agreements, for clarifying and training personnel in roles and responsibility, for improving interagency coordination and communications, for identifying gaps and resources, improving individual performance, and identifying opportunities for improvement. Exercises are one facet of the TTE program and CAP that will eventually root the BCP deeply into the utility and turn a plan into a way of doing business. Exercises provide an opportunity for the water utility to assist in training the public and other emergency responders to cooperate and assist each other during the recovery period. Exercises allow leaders to test and evaluate personnel, interdependencies, and programs working together in a non-threatening environment that simulates emergency conditions. Exercises may be worked into the schedule plan for emergency management, however, they should practice specific aspects of the BCP, for example, employees in continuity roles, notification systems, IT recovery procedures, or extended operations at an alternate location. You should exercise procedures in your BCP to build skills in a non-threatening environment. The DHS Homeland Security Exercise and Evaluation Program, or HSEEP, designates the seven types of exercises shown. Orientation, training, tests, tabletop exercises, and operational exercises are ways to introduce continuity concepts and assure familiarity and even expertise with implementation of the BCP. Some utilities have achieved training goals by offering exercises in brown bag lunch forums, internal team competitions, and as performance incentives. Some involve operational commitment, including in-depth planning, personnel, equipment, and budget. All exercise levels are scalable to the size and needs of the utility, and you can easily adjust readily available materials from the US EPA and HSEEP. Small utilities may prefer to join others in their WARN exercises. They may also elect to participate with first responder agencies or their local emergency management agency to participate fully and gain the most benefit from full-scale exercises. Learn from real incidents and analyze them for corrective action. Lessons learned and after-action reports can be found at www.llis.gov. Take advantage of and participate in exercises scheduled for a greater area, such as your county, city, UWASI, or state. FEMA conducts national-level exercises and invites at least online or observer participation well in advance. Invitations to participate are frequently announced by Water ISAC. In this module, we will focus on tabletop exercises and simulations, as these are most readily available for water utility use or customization with limited budgets and staff. Tabletop exercises allow the leaders of the organization to explore imaginative and interesting problem scenarios in a non-threatening environment without commitment of people and equipment. It is also very easy for the BCP coordinator or training staff to develop tabletop exercises that fit into the budget of the organization. Schedule games as lunch and learn sessions or other social events. Doing so also enables the leaders of an organization to develop a sense of camaraderie for which there may be few opportunities in today's business environment. Tabletop exercises can be developed to work through a specific section of the BCP and fit within set time parameters. The exercise coordinator must have a scenario developed with sufficient guidance and planned interventions, known as injects, to move the scenario along to its conclusion. The coordinator may find it useful to take advantage of some of the tabletop exercises that have been developed by EPA and Homeland Security. Regardless of how they're developed, all exercises should have a period set aside for a hot wash or lessons learned. Establish a threat scenario and an impact point. Test the processes or strategies developed in the BCP and use the BCP for exercise rather than relying on past practice. This will also enable experiential learning. If the exercise sheds light on additional gaps, a corrective action plan should be initiated and managers held accountable for improvements. Join other agencies in the Warren, County EMA, or UASI to participate in functional or full-scale exercises. Participate when possible in pertinent national-level exercises. Invitations are issued well in advance of the exercise and usually are announced through Water ISAC or other water sector publications. One form of acquiring experience in a non-threatening environment is a customized simulation that can be used to explain and train topics for business continuity. While there are commercial products available, the Emergency Management Institute offers through the FEMA website some general exercise planning courses and has even designed some courses specifically for water and public work interests. The U.S. EPA has also developed basic scenarios for tabletop exercises which can be further customized. These can be found on their water security page. One of the first steps in creating an exercise is to develop a scenario. Scenarios should be based on the risks faced by your water utility and documented in your BCP. There is neither time nor budget to run tabletop exercises or simulations for scenarios that are not relevant, and you risk losing not only the employee's interest, but your credibility as a facilitator. You can gradually make scenarios more complex, but always remain realistic. You can draw scenario storylines from actual incidents or use scenarios available in the public domain customized to your BCP. Complexity increases, especially in smaller utilities, where you will likely be running these with the same employees repeatedly. You should try to challenge the participants, but not overwhelm them. Model manuals are available from the HCEP or from US EPA's Water Security webpage. These provide structure and game rules for your tabletop exercise, as well as set goals and objectives for participant learning and performance. When the exercise concludes, the after-action report confirms lessons learned and documents the plan for corrective action, if necessary. Given the flooding scenario just described, you should ask yourself the following questions. Is there a trigger here for implementing the BCP? Is there a role for the BCP coordinator in the scenario, and if so, what is it? Which MEFs would be most likely affected by this scenario? What are critical steps in implementing the BCP? What are the ramifications of damage to IT and engineering for the sustainment of MEFs? We'll let you answer these questions, but the fact that your RTO is significantly smaller than the estimated time to remove the water is a pretty good indicator that swift action is necessary. The key to conducting a good tabletop discussion is to cause staff to think about possible threat situations beforehand while they're not under the stress caused by difficult situations. It is not unrealistic to combine stressors which may and frequently do occur during the same season or environment. However, don't build in so many complications as to cause staff to lose interest in devising solutions. It's an important part of the learning process to be able to overcome the obstacles with BCP tools at hand, or if unable, to revisit certain plans and procedures to make corrections or different provisions. The tabletop exercise should be thought-provoking. It is one environment in which the question, "What if?" is totally welcome. The exercise facilitator should have a facilitator manual which provides guidance for asking questions that will both direct and stimulate the discussion. It may also be useful to provide the participants with a manual that establishes the rules of the exercise and any background information they may want as references. Participants and facilitators should always work in the exercise environment with their own customized BCP. That is one reasonable way to validate the plan. The example scenario described here includes multiple stressors, the influenza epidemic, and the inclement weather. If your utility is conducting exercises for the first time, it may be advisable to first conduct the exercise without the complications of a storm. The scenario just described is significantly different than the first scenario, but you can see that the loss of utility employees for extended periods could just as easily disrupt business continuity. Some of the questions you ask yourself will be the same, but you will probably need to consult another part of your family of plans, the pandemic plan. At the conclusion of the exercise, it is critical to have a hot wash, normally conducted by the BCP coordinator, to allow the participants to discuss and document how things went, what was learned, and what action items need to be addressed to improve preparedness. Later, an after-action report will be prepared by the facilitator or the BCP coordinator to apprise the utility executive of progress and to assure that necessary adjustments are made to the Corrective Action Program, or CAP. Document the results of an exercise, no matter how small, in an after-action report with recommendations for corrective action. The BCP guide describes the CAP as part of the Plan, Act, Do, Check management system. Exercises and the CAP form a major portion of the check component. The CAP is more than a report, graph, or other kind of document. It is a continuous improvement process for formally documenting and reporting tests and the results to executives and staff. There is no reason to make such a report or presentation if no action, delegation, or control is anticipated. However, if actions are anticipated, you should incorporate standard business process into your BCP for tracking the CAP and validating actions taken. Track recommendations for performance improvement in the CAP with a point of contact assigned within the utility. This prevents the frustration of repeated performance problems in successive exercises. It also, by design, moves the utility forward towards stated resiliency objectives. Problems noted should be tested again in future exercises. Please proceed to Module 13, BCP Program Management. The BCP program lends itself well to a systems management approach, although there may be other satisfactory ways to manage continuity. The Plan, Do, Check, Act management cycle is a recommended method that is already familiar to many in the water sector, but utilities should choose a system that best suits their needs. In this module, you will learn best practices for applying the basic systems management approach to BCP to ensure accountability within your program. A management system is the framework of processes and procedures used to ensure that an organization can effectively fulfill all tasks required to achieve its objectives. It is recommended that a business continuity program use a management system, such as the Plan, Do, Check, Act cycle, to ensure that the plan is effective and continually improved. When we plan, we want to establish management system policy, objectives, processes, and procedures relevant to managing business continuity risks and improving response and recovery processes that deliver results in accordance with the organization's strategic needs. What we do is implement and operate the management system policy controls, processes, and procedures. When we check, we monitor, assess, measure, and review performance against management system policy, objectives, and practical experience. We report the results to the management for review, and we determine and authorize actions for remediation and improvement. We then act. We take corrective and preventive actions based on the results of the internal management system audit and management review, reappraising the scope of the business continuity management system and business continuity policy and objectives to achieve continual improvement of the management system. In the emergency management system, corrective actions are generated through risk assessments, plan reviews, after-action reports after tests and exercises, and after-action reports after real incidents. It is necessary to document these corrective actions and manage them together in a plan. The plan prioritizes them and identifies who is responsible for the corrective action. It also states the scheduled start and completion dates for each corrective action. During BCP committee meetings, it is a best management practice to revisit and discuss the status of the corrective action plan. If other meetings at the utility discuss the corrective action plan, then the BCP committee meetings address just the BCP-related corrective actions in the plan. Next, we're going to present other best management practices for making the business continuity plan part of the utility culture. We'll show how to make it a viable, updated plan that is distributed to the appropriate people while maintaining the security of the plan. For a BCP to be effective, it needs to become part of the culture. Every organization, including water utilities, has a culture. Although culture is intangible and often taken for granted, it provides a set of core values and assumptions and guides day-to-day activities of personnel in the workplace. One common driving factor for cultural change is experiencing a significant crisis, such as a catastrophic incident. Too often, it is not until such an incident occurs that an organization changes its practices in emergency management and begins developing a BCP. In these cases, a BCP is typically embraced in earnest. A catastrophic incident is not necessary to shift a culture. Once water utility leadership commits to developing a BCP, there are best practices for changing the culture and making the plan more effective. Key factors to facilitate this shift include these elements. Top managers at the utility are role models for BCP preparedness through their active participation. The utility provides BCP training. The utility recognizes the value of BCP by reviewing performance and making improvements. Finally, utility leaders encourage employee participation. If the decision is made to not distribute the BCP to all employees, a distribution list should be developed that includes all positions in the utility that have been designated as having key roles in the BCP during response, recovery, and reconstitution. Be sure to consider agents outside the utility who are integral to the continued operation of the utility MEFs who should receive portions of the plan. These could include outside counsel, local first responder agencies, an external media consultant, and critical customers or suppliers. Any sensitive materials can be placed in annexes or appendices that can be subject to less universal distribution. Likewise, rip-and-run BCP checklists can be posted in separate appendices for wider or urgent distribution during a critical incident, provided these are current and employees have received general training in their use. Good administrative practices ensure that changes to the plan are posted and properly distributed. Change management should be systematic and consistent, and it should ensure everyone on the distribution list is notified of the changes. Some utilities collect all of the changes for annual review, but some utilities may wish to make updates more frequently. Security and safety protocols establish physical security, protect sensitive information, and ensure that the plan is available and accessible to employees when needed. Some of the information in the appendices of the BCP, if made public, could compromise the operations of the utility and the privacy of the utility employees. In addition, the disclosure of certain information in this plan could compromise the security of essential equipment, services, and systems of the utility, or otherwise detrimentally affect the ability of the utility to perform essential functions. Consider whether such information, if released to the general public or the news media, would have a negative impact on the continuous operation of the utility MEFs. Portions of the BCP may contain information that raise personal privacy or other concerns, and those portions may be exempt from mandatory disclosure under the Freedom of Information Act. Also, be sure that accessibility conforms to local FOIA and Sunshine laws, as most protect against the release of sensitive critical infrastructure resource information. Some utilities include their legal counsel in the BCP committee, thus protecting sensitive information by lawyer-client privilege. Decisions made with regard to security and accessibility should also consider storage. Remember that automated IT services may be interrupted when the BCP is activated. At least once a year, the BCP coordinator and committee revise the BCP as necessary. The BCP committee may deem it necessary to devise a systematic process for reviewing and revising the plan. Tests and exercises scheduled throughout the year provide additional insight as to the frequency of changes. When it is time to update the plan, an inventory of the new systems, priorities, personnel, procedures, and promises to customers should be assessed. Some utilities make use of the CAP program to ensure that planned revisions are properly incorporated. It may not be possible to continuously revise the plan and successfully ensure that every employee takes note and receives training. Like most of the other processes associated with the business continuity planning efforts, planned maintenance is risk-based. Weigh the risk of continuous improvement against the risk of inefficient and ineffective management of the change process, always considering the threat environment. It is a best practice to make sure that the CEO reads and authenticates changes, at least on an annual basis. Review and comment by the CEO is one of the most effective ways to ensure that utility employees incorporate BCP-related changes into routine operations as well. Once you have developed your plan, how do you know it will work when you need it? One way is to test it through exercises and training. However, there are other elements to consider. First and foremost, a viable plan is current. To be current, it must be maintained. Plan maintenance means keeping contact lists current and ensuring that strategies, timeframes for response and recovery, and resource inventories are up to date and meet the utility requirements. These requirements may change periodically, for example, when the served population increases or decreases, in the aftermath of a critical incident, when facilities are renovated, or when new equipment and systems are installed. Much like the operational environment of a utility itself, typical impediments to viability are found in such mundane aspects of continuity planning as the distribution, maintenance, and security of the plan. Here, the demands of scalability tend to work against the larger utilities and in favor of the smaller utilities. The larger and more complex the task to distribute, maintain, and protect the utility BCP, the more things can go wrong. And if it can go wrong, it likely will, at the exact moment you need it most. The key elements to a successful program are finding a BCP management system that works for your utility and maintaining accountability for the management of the plan. Accountability starts at the top and it continues through all levels to ensure that all resources and information are available when needed. We will now move on to Module 14, Additional Resources. Still at a loss for how to begin your plan? BCP is not as new to other critical infrastructure sectors as perhaps it is to the water sector. There are many places and resources to turn to in order to get the assistance you may need. In this module, you'll find links to agencies in the government and private sector that may be helpful in beginning or improving your utility BCP. Background research for the preparation of the guidance document uncovered several resources developed by governments and professional organizations to help with business continuity planning. This list of resources, which is continued on the next slide, can be found in Appendix C of the BCP guidance document if you need additional information to help you understand and document your BCP. These resources are not designed specifically for the water sector, but they are recognized standards for business continuity guidance in general. Again, they may be found in Appendix C of the Water Research Foundation's Business Continuity Plan Guidance document. The National Archives and Record Administration, NARA, issues guidance concerning vital records and associated protection and accessibility measures. As with the previous resources, this guidance is not specific to the needs of water-wastewater utility operations. Guidance concerning automated information systems is also available from the IT-ISAC and Information Technology Sector-Specific Protection Plan. Additional guidance for identifying vital records is available from your local county emergency management office and the U.S. EPA. There are numerous resources for exercises and training, and a good place to start is in the public domain. Always examine what is available in the public domain, even if you have to pay for customization. It's much less expensive and time-consuming than creating something new. While there is no specific regulatory requirement to use it, the Homeland Security Exercise and Evaluation Program offers a wealth of guidance and a document library of tools and scenarios to use in developing the utility BCP exercises. The EPA Water Security Toolkit, also known as the ERP Toolkit, also offers an array of exercise guides, models, and templates that can be adjusted for use in achieving relevant BCP training goals. Using the library available will save you considerable expense in hiring suitable training consultants to prepare and facilitate this kind of training and/or evaluation. The websites llis.gov, hsdl.gov, and hseep.gov all carry searchable templates, exercise scenarios, and lessons learned reports from local, state, and national exercises. In June 2010, US EPA published the Tabletop Exercise Tool for Water Systems, Emergency Preparedness, Response, and Climate Resiliency, also known as the TTX tool. The TTX tool is designed to assist those interested in planning and facilitating tabletop exercises on water sector-related issues. The TTX tool expands on the capabilities of the ERP tool published in 2005 and is a valuable asset for many utilities. Exercises can be inexpensive, but they are rarely free. The more complex the exercise, the more it costs. Grants are sometimes available for exercises of the BCP and other plans, and several are listed on this slide. To be eligible for the grant, your utility is generally required to be compliant with NIMS and ICS. The size and collaboration levels for the grants change from year to year depending on the perceived need. Generally, these grants also have a life cycle. DHS posts training and exercise grant information in late January for application submission by the end of March. State-level grants are then dispersed to subordinate agencies. If you are in a major metro area or a high-threat area, get together with the UWASI board. Also, most counties have a disaster planning committee or even an LEPC, so these may be better options for smaller utilities. Finally, the state warrants have gained significant standing in the emergency preparedness community, which may result in increased water sector funding from local emergency committees and state agencies.